Greetings, Fright Knights. We just saw Unfriended, a movie that I didn't want to see.
Neither did I, really.
But it was getting so much attention, we were like, well, we better.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, we're not really the horror guys. We're not doing our job.
True enough.
And I think the moral of the story is sometimes your job blows, no matter how great it is otherwise. That might be a little harsh, though, because... All right, you want a quick capsule review. How is Unfriended?
I'm a little mixed on it. I think I'm a little more positive than he is on it, but it's definitely a mixed bag of a movie. I don't know whether to recommend it or not, because there are things that are wrong with the movie that could potentially break the movie for some people. But there's also a lot of things that work in this movie that for some people might be more effective than it was for me. So I don't know.
Yeah, for me personally, like, if I was to either say it sucked or recommend it, both would be a lie, but saying it sucked would be less of a lie.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, man. Like, there were times when I was kind of into it,
and then
it just kind of dropped the ball.
Mm-hmm.
I was really surprised when you told me it was rated R. I was like, it was rated R?
I know, really? Especially since that this is the kind of movie where, given the premise of the movie, it actually would have behooved them to have some nudity. Not titillating nudity.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, it's... There's a difference between titillating nudity and nudity for plot effect. And in this movie, given that this is a movie about cyberbullying, having some incriminating photos of various characters show up would not have been out of place. But instead, it's like photos of like people like smoking out of a bong. And I'm like, no high school I know is gonna harass you for smoking out of a bong. But they might if they find you with your pants down in some random person that you shouldn't be sleeping with.
Yeah.
You know? Like, so I... All right, let's start the spoilers now. All right.
Yeah.
So for those of you who don't know, Unfriended is about a group of friends in a Skype call, and this is the anniversary of when one of their friends died by suicide. And the reason why she died is she committed suicide after essentially a video was leaked of her online getting really drunk, and it ends with her passed out on, I guess, like beside this trailer. I'm not sure what
it was.
She's passed out beside a trailer, and she shit her pants because she was so fucking drunk and out of it. And the video went viral, and her entire high school made her the laughing stock, and she shot herself in the face. This movie takes place on the anniversary of her death, and a bunch of friends have got together in a Skype call just to kind of hang out, and weird things start happening. Now, the first thing you gotta know about Unfriended is that the entire movie is a computer screen. There is no cutting out of the computer screen. You're not looking at people's reactions. You're only seeing it through their webcams on their actual screen. And it's not cutting from computer screen to computer screen. It's all this one character's computer screen. So that right there is gonna turn a whole lot of people off, and understandably so. That part actually started to work for me about halfway through, because they started actually really capturing what it feels like to be on a computer typing with your friends all night. They actually got that really well, even if they took a few liberties with the, just because you bring up a window in front of your Skype conversation does not mean the Skype conversation is now turned down to a low volume. That's not how it works.
But, yeah.
But they did that for dramatic effect.
Yeah, for dramatic effect and for clarity.
Yeah, yeah. Because otherwise it would just be a mess of information happening to you at once.
Too much would be happening at once. And that's definitely one of the flaws of the movie. There are a lot of times in this movie where you're like, I don't know where I'm supposed to be looking right now. So I'm just looking at everything. And
I can't say I had that problem. I actually thought they made it very clear where you're supposed to look. I actually think you just have that problem with the computer screen in general.
Ugh.
Because actually, while I was watching the movie, I was like, oh, okay, the mouse is there. Okay, it actually was very easy for me to follow that part, honestly.
Yeah, no, I think I just hated it. Mm. I think I just hated the movie. There are things that work, but in the end, like, I didn't care.
Mm-hmm.
The thing at the end with the ghost,
Oh, the jump scare.
Yeah, the jump scare.
That was really bad.
Is so bad.
That was. That was a really bad ending. The jump scare, not leading up to the ending, but the jump scare itself just felt really out of place. And it was an obvious attempt to say, hey, Paranormal Activity had an ending like this. And so does Sinister. So we're going to do that ending. And it didn't work in Sinister. And it did work in Paranormal Activity. But people don't seem to realize how it worked in that one. Like, it wasn't just a jump scare. There's this all this tension leading up to it that's not in this movie. It's just, oh, man. Wow. That was out of place.
Done. Yeah.
That was really out of place.
Yeah.
Especially since, given the plot of the movie, there actually is an appropriate ending they could have gone with.
Yeah.
It's not the sexy ending. It's not the exciting ending, but it's the ending that would fit the story that they told. And the entire story basically unfolds that you find out that these group of friends are all partially responsible for what happened to the dead girl. And the dead girl, her ghost is now haunting their computers and basically making them all, you know, admit what they did and forcing them commit suicide one after another. There's a really intense game of Never Would I Ever.
Yeah, Never Have I Ever.
Never Have I Ever. That was actually really good, but it just had really shitty payoffs, but we'll get to that. It was really intense when they're doing that and everyone's like admitting like, yeah, I slept with her. Oh yeah, I roofied that chick. Ah, nah, nah. And then they're screaming at each other because they're finding out secrets about one another. And it's just building to this intense moment. And then they're slowly getting picked off one by one. And then you get to the end and it turns out that the girl who took the video of the girl who was dead, the one who actually took the video, the one that destroyed that girl's life and made her commit suicide, that's the main character that we've been following the whole time. And basically the ghost basically leaks the end of the video that she didn't upload online that shows her turning the camera to herself and saying like, what was it? Like, I got her or something like that. And laughing her ass off at the girl that's passed out drunk with her shit pants. And leaks that part online and tags her in it. So then everybody around the school basically starts like, just commenting on that, like, you fucking killed her, you fucking monster, how dare you do that, effectively ruining this girl's life, which is the appropriate just desserts ending for the movie. You could have ended it there with just now your life's in shambles and it's ruined, but instead they decide to go with this really, really out of place jump scare ending that has no place in this movie. Yeah.
Well, like, it even would have worked if she had been like, if she had fucking, it would have worked if, you know, she sees all that stuff, she breaks down, and then she, like, legit commits suicide.
Yeah, that would have been good, too. That would have been really good. Either one of those would have been appropriate.
Yeah, as opposed to, the ghost slaps down the laptop.
Instead, it went with formula. It went with the current formula since Paranormal Activity, where it's got to have that jump scare ending, this Spielberg jump scare ending that Spielberg recommended director of fucking Paranormal Activity. Spielberg recommended him the ending that eventually made it into the movie. And I thought it was the right choice because the other endings were kind of balls. And it was really effective in the movie. But then every movie that tried to copy that kind of did it really shitty.
Yeah, they did it really bad.
And this movie's no exception.
No, it really isn't. As a film, there are things in it that don't suck that are actually pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
Like the tension building during the game.
Yeah,
is pretty cool.
You know, as each character's revealing something, and another character's like, "You did that to me. You're the one who ratted me out. You did this," and they're slowly just dismantling their friendships one by one. You know, like you're the one who spread the rumor that I had an eating disorder. Like, you bitch, and just. Slowly, one by one.
Yeah.
And it's really tense. And then you have this, like, really cool moment where two of the characters receive a, like, their printer just prints out this piece of paper. Just the ghost makes it print out this piece of paper, and they both read it, but they can't tell anyone in the call what it says on there. But at this point, the characters are so angry at one another and that now there's another secret getting in between them that they're freaking out. And the character that found out that the main character had cheated on her is just like, no, I can't handle any more secrets. Tell me what's on the fucking paper. Show me what's on the paper. And you're building up to this because you know it can't be good.
Yeah, you know it can't be good.
You know, and then he's like, I'll walk away. I'm leaving right now if you do. At this point, the characters are too scared to leave because the ghost basically said, if you do, you're dead.
Yeah, if you leave, I'll just kill you.
And the ghost is even saying that even more as the thing's building up and it's cutting between that.
Yeah.
And then she freaks out because she doesn't want her boyfriend to die. So she holds up the piece of paper and it says, if you show them the paper, then Adam dies, which is another character. And then Adam quickly pulls up this gun that he's been holding the whole time and shoots himself in the head. And it was the one time there was an effective payoff to a tense moment. Whereas most of the suicides in this movie are either done off camera or done in this quick cutting fucking glitchy camera thing, so you glitchy. Can't really see what's going on, so it does nothing. I was just like, wow, that kid putting his face in the blender would have been awesome if we saw it.
Yeah, pretty much. It was the big consistent problem where just everything just felt like, oh well, okay, that's over.
Yeah. And you're like, that would have been your fucking money shot if you did it.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, him putting his hand in the blender, then it's like, now he's putting his face in the blender, but it's all like so fast that it doesn't leave any fucking impact. And you're like, it's already grainy as shit. You're already doing that digital artifacting thing that is kind of like a problem with like really shitty streaming and really bad internet connections. You're already doing that, so why did you need to add more ways to make it hard to see by adding the quick cutting thing? Because already you can hide so many shitty effects just by having that grain.
Yeah, it was like that's why when you said yeah it was an R rating, I'm like, wow.
Yeah.
Wow, can you not do anything in a fucking horror movie anymore?
I don't know. People turned on violence and gore in movies, even though horror movies kind of need it.
Yeah.
Especially if you're going to make a horror movie where people die graphic deaths. You can't do that without showing the graphic death. Like, there's a character who commits suicide in this movie, but the camera, the laptop that the camera is showing on the webcam falls down off the table when she kills herself. So we don't even see how she does it. We don't know if she slits her wrist or she chugs that gallon of bleach that's right next to her head.
Yeah, open bottle of bleach right next to her.
You don't know what she does, and it doesn't ever tell you or show you. And I'm like, well, how am I supposed to feel anything if you're not gonna give me anything to like chew on? Like no substance. It's just.
Yeah, like the ironic thing is the character that you do kind of end up rooting for is the ghost.
Yeah. And the ghost is a fucking bastard in this, and I actually enjoyed the ghost's sense of humor. Like, it would, like, kill a character and then play, like, an ironic song on one of the on the main character's playlist, and it was just like, wow, okay, that's kind of cool. That's kind of funny. And especially as it becomes very clear that this is a Just Dessert story, so you can root for the ghost as it starts happening.
You could root for the killer in this one,
mm-hmm.
You know, which made it kind of all the more, all the more kind of disappointing if they just went with a typical jump scare ending.
I know, because it was so bad. It was so out of place. It was the Sinister ending. And even it even didn't work very well in Sinister, and I liked that movie, but that ending was balls.
Yeah.
And the thing leading up to that, the ghost releasing the video, everyone commenting on it, her freaking out, and then the ghost signing off, that was really effective. It just shit the bed in the next 5 seconds.
Yeah. Just poopy.
You know, it's one of those things where even if I was enjoying the movie up to that point, it leaves a real sour taste in your mouth when you leave the theater.
I'm kind of mad at the movie for a bunch of meta reasons that have nothing to do with the movie. It's not fair, but I'll be honest, because I was like, I don't really like this movie, but it's not really bad enough to hate.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's some decent acting. There's some good stuff happening. Mm-hmm. It's not so hilariously incompetent that or so groan inducing that it causes pain, but there are a few times when you wonder, I was kind of wondering would I, if this was on Netflix, would I keep watching?
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't know. I don't know. There was a like slightly similar movie that was made with the same style of being like entirely a computer screen, called Open Windows. It was made by the guy who made Time Crimes, which is a movie I really like, and has Elijah Wood in it. And that movie, the moment I realized it was called Open Windows because it was all on a computer screen, I almost shut it off right there.
Yeah. I remember you telling me about that. Like, you're like, I almost punched the screen.
Yeah, I almost punched the screen when I found that out. I'm like, are you fucking kidding me? That's why it's called Open. I fucking hate you. But I kept watching, and that movie wasn't very good, and I didn't finish it. And I don't know if I would have finished this one either. Even though I liked this one more.
Yes.
Just because there were so many parts where I'm like, oh man, this is good. This is good. Oh man. And then a character would be forced to commit suicide and they'd shoot it really shittily and give me nothing to go on. So like it just falls flat. So it's like tension, 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 tension. Boom. Well,
yeah. That was disappointing. It's like, I don't even know what. It's like making out for really heavy making out for like 10 minutes and then like you got to go back to second base.
Yeah, that happens a lot.
You know, like you feel like, the movie, one of the big problems of the movie just doesn't really get you off.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it doesn't indulge in dark gleefulness
mm-hmm.
the way it should.
There are parts where it does. There are
parts where it does.
Like the moment when it's like a character is forced to commit suicide because they're lying, and then like the ghost starts playing that "You're a lie song.
Yeah,
that was kind of gleefully dark and ghoulish, but they needed more of that.
Yeah, they needed way more of that, which is why I definitely agree. Like if they had gone for full on, just like, you know, bloody graphic death, that would have been way more satisfying. Yeah,
well, plus, like, you already had it so grainy that if the guy put his hand in the blender or his face in the blender the way he does in the movie, that actually would have been more effective than cutting away from it. Like,
yeah.
Because then you could, because it's so grainy, you won't be able to tell that it's not, you know, really his hand.
Yeah. Like, the movie that keeps coming to mind when I think about it, nothing like this movie except that it's also, like, you know, grainy footage with artifacting is Grave Encounters 2.
Oh, yeah.
But I really liked how stupid that movie got.
The Grave Encounters movies are for the most part, just okay, and they have some good moments. The first one's kind of ruined by a lot of really shitty CGI that doesn't work very well. And the second one is kind of saved by how stupid it goes.
Yeah.
It gets so stupid you can't help but be along for the ride and just be like, all right, I gotta see what crazy direction this story ends up taking.
Yeah, it almost tries too hard in this brilliant way.
Yeah.
We're just sort of like, where is this going?
Yep. You know?
Yep. And then when it tells you, you're like, what?
Yep. So you were comparing those movies to
Yeah. Like Grave Encounters gave you that redonkulous plot twist at the end.
Yes.
That was so amazingly fucking stupid. But it was so but it was appropriate to what was going on.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was really stupid. If you want a spoiler for Grave Encounters 2, the twist is that the asylum that they're all locked in wants the film team to finish the movie.
Finish the movie so he can release it?
Yeah, so that the film could be released.
I gotta finish the movie. The asylum demands it.
I'll finish your movie. He's just like, wow.
And it's implied that the asylum has like a shady production company somewhere in Hollywood.
Yes.
That releases behind the scenes information of the movie. You're like,
yeah. You're like, that is so dumb and so out of left field.
You can't hate it.
Yeah. No, you really can't hate it. It's like the ending of Carnosaur.
Oh, man.
Yeah. What?
Yes.
Oh, the military's here to save us. End.
Yes.
It's why I can't hate Carnosaur, despite a lot of bullshit in that movie.
There's a lot of bullshit, but it's glorious bullshit.
Yeah, but like, I was kind of hoping that Unfriended would go in that direction. It would either get like so stupid, it would flip over to enjoyable, or that it was actually going to be, actually be like this hidden gem that it's like, oh, this is actually not too bad. I see why they thought this would work well in a theater. And I was really afraid that it was just going to be complete, utter balls. And I was going to wish that I hadn't gone to the theater.
Yeah.
To be honest, the fucking trailer for Pixels, the new Adam Sandler picture, was way more painful than this movie.
The thing that every time I see anything for that movie, I'm just like, didn't Futurama already do this joke?
It kind of did. It's that Futurama. It's that one, like, Tales to Astound,
where everything's a video
game. I don't know.
And I don't think you're going to top it with fucking Paul Blart and Adam Sandler.
No.
Yeah, that was a really bad trailer.
Yeah, well, it's one of those, like, oh, it's Adam Sandler running around like a jackass again.
It doesn't make you feel the way Wreck-It Ralph did.
No, not at all.
Wreck-It Ralph, like, brought you back to being a little kid, like, playing an arcade or playing your Super Nintendo. But the Pixels trailer just makes you want to throw away every system you ever owned.
Yeah.
It's just...
makes you want to find an Atari 2600 and burn it.
Yeah. And all the other trailers we watched were all kind of, they're all Blumhouse pictures that all kind of have the same kind of ghostly thing going on. I don't mind Blumhouse, but like, this formula is starting to wear a little thin on me. It was already starting to wear a little thin on me a year ago. But now that every single trailer attached to this was all a Blumhouse ghostly story.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh man, come on, make a slasher or something. Make a werewolf movie. I don't know anything.
And you want to know the most insulting thing? Yeah, we're picking on the trailers now. The most insulting trailer was one for a movie called The Visit.
Oh yeah.
And it was like, oh, we're staying at Grandma and Grandpa's place, but like, Grandma and Grandpa are really weird. Like, they might be demons or witches or cannibals.
Yeah,
they might
be
something. And the trailer doesn't tell you, because obviously that's the movie.
There was a couple like effective moments in that trailer.
Yeah. And you're like, oh my God, I want to see this movie. And then the last bit of the trailer in big letters from writer-director M. Night Shyamalan. I'm like, no!
It's amazing how much bad faith that guy's built up at this point. So yeah, you're like watching the trailer. I'm like, oh, I might be into this. But here's the thing. I remember watching the first trailer for Devil and feeling that way. And The Village and feeling that way. And The Happening and feeling that way.
Yes.
And then finally seeing all those movies. And
how many of those are good?
So, unless people tell me that it is Shyamalan's back to form, I don't think I'm going to be seeing that one.
No.
I don't. And don't you dare request that we go see that thing. I will find you. I will find you.
Fucking end you.
And there was a bunch of other trailers, but the problem is they all kind of blend together in my head because they were all from Blumhouse Productions.
Like Insidious 3... Poltergeist.
That one was Ghost House.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah, that was a Ghost House production one. That was a Sam Raimi company. And the weird thing about it is, like, Sam Raimi's company and his style doesn't look like it's going to mesh with Poltergeist as a story. Because you're like, no, Sam Raimi likes to make really fun horror movies. Like, he and his company want to make. But Poltergeist is a little different. It's an 80s.
It's a family movie.
It's a family movie. It's not like a Raimi style movie, and trying to make it into one, I don't know if it's going to work.
Yeah. Also, I don't know if you can update that movie.
Yeah, I don't know either.
And setting it just back in the time period would be pointless.
Well, you already feel something's missing when they get to the ghost hunter, and it's very obviously they went with someone complete opposite of Zelda Rubinstein.
Yeah.
I hope I got that name right.
I think that's right.
Yeah. I hope I got it right. If I did, I apologize.
And it was Rubenstein.
Feel free to correct me down below. But like, they got the guy, the British dude who was, fucking, he's been in fucking everything, but he was Moriarty in the Sherlock Holmes, Robert Downey Jr. sequel. He was one of the villains in Fringe. He's been in just about everything under the sun. I'm sure you look him up and you'll find at least something that you love that he was in.
Yeah.
And he's playing the ghost hunter in it. And whenever he gets on screen and starts talking in the trailer, you're like, yeah, I really miss Zelda.
Yeah. Yeah. You can't replace that Tangina.
Yeah. She had so much atmosphere just in her voice.
Yeah.
You know, like she brought so much character just with her voice.
Well, that's why when she shows up in like Beyond the Mask, it's kind of fucking
behind the mask.
It's kind of fucking amazing. But she's just like, oh, don't worry, dearie. It's just an old story.
Absolutely.
It's like, ah, so good.
There was one about, I guess, it was another Blumhouse one. It wasn't Ghostly, but it was, it had Jason Bateman and like some old friend of his from college or something like that who gets all creepy on his wife.
Oh, The Gift. Yeah.
Yeah. That trailer was weird because I felt like I had seen the whole movie by the end of the trailer.
Yeah.
There was another one that was like that. There was another trailer we had that felt like it was the entire movie, but I can't remember what it was. There was Sinister 3.
Was it Sinister or Insidious?
Insidious 3.
Yeah, Insidious 3.
Insidious 3. Sorry. You can understand why I made that mistake.
I totally can.
Insidious 3 and I love Insidious 1. Insidious 2 is balls. Insidious 2 is hilariously awful. So I might see Insidious 3 just to see if it's as funny as 2 was. But based on the trailer, I don't know.
I'm predicting a gnashing of teeth and a tearing out of hair.
Probably.
Taking of souls.
Probably. I don't think you're gonna be able to capture how hilarious 2 was.
Like, you said it best. It's like, this is the kind of awful that only a really brilliant director makes.
Yes, yes. Much like I think it was the Cinema Snob who compared it to The Exorcist 2. And I think like that. You have a really brilliant director and they have a lot of talent. But that means that if they make a bad movie, it's a really talented bad movie. And
actually making the old woman ghost A man,
which is like, no,
was like what?
What That's made it scary dumb. In the first movie was that they actually did put a man in that suit, and so you knew something was off, but you didn't know what, and that's what made it so creepy. But then actually making it a man made it less creepy.
Well, yeah, like
because now it's just evil crossdresser. Like,
yeah, well, Sinister 2 basically retroactively ruined scares that worked in the first movie.
Yes. Time travel. They introduced time travel in a ghost movie. And went back to scares from the first movie and made them unscary. I've never seen a movie so retroactively ruin an original movie as much as this one did. That was...
Yeah, it was pretty amazing.
Usually when a sequel comes out, I'm like, well, a sequel doesn't ruin the original movie. But then this one actually goes back to the original
movie. This one goes out of its way to ruin the original movie. Like, I can't believe it. Like I see... Now whenever I... Oh god, what's the name of that actor? He's also in Hard Candy. Fuck, he plays a dad.
God damn it. Fucking the owl.
Yeah.
From Watchmen. God damn it. It's gonna be on the tip of my fucking tongue.
Yeah, but like the dad from the Insidious movies. Every time I see him in something post that, my initial reaction is, you were in Insidious 2. I don't trust you anymore.
I think his name is like Patrick something. I can't.
It's like Patrick Wilson or something.
Yeah, something like that. Something like that.
Yeah.
I actually like that guy, but
no, he's really good. He plays like My favorite role, I think, ultimately, like, just across the board is the pedophile in Hard Candy.
Oh, yeah. He's great
you
in that.
You know, like, he's really good in that.
A movie so horrifying, it makes you feel bad for a pedophile.
Yeah,
I can't believe that.
Oh, wow.
It really brings some dark things inside of you. Ooh, like that's why I like it.
That's why I like it.
Yeah, it's really at the same time, it's a just desserts, too. So
It is. It absolutely is.
It fulfills both things. It horrifies you by revealing dark parts of yourself while also giving you kind of the cathartic, oh man, she got the pedophile.
Yeah.
You know? Oh God, love Hard Candy. I think we've diverged a little far.
The problem is really hard to find things about Unfriended that are worth talking about.
That's true. I mean, I really like the overall story, the idea of like a cyberbullying ghost, like kids cyberbullied some girl and then she comes back for vengeance and fucks with them online. I actually really like that. I just feel like this could have been executed way better.
Yeah. Because I know someone's going to ask, because a lot of the requests for us to see this movie came because of the review of The Den that I had done. So, is it as bad as The Den? Okay, here's the frustrating thing. It is neither as good as The Den gets or as awful as The Den gets.
Ah, I can see that. I can see that.
Because there are some scenes in The Den that are just amazing, but the movie overall is just a complete...
Yeah.
It's completely fucking ruined.
I can see that.
You know, but by the same token, Unfriended neither reaches those highs nor those lows.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're kind of left with this really, really middling movie. And the thing that really kind of irritates me is I'm thinking about what it takes for these actors, these young actors, to be in the emotional state they need to be in order to do this movie. Because it's one of those movies where, you know, it's in real time.
Yeah.
You know, there's obviously some cutting, but they are crying, weeping, and gnashing their teeth the majority of the film.
Yeah. Well, basically, anytime it, like, takes away from the webcam, like, and, like, puts, like, a window in front of it, they have room to cut something.
Yeah.
But even then, like, most of the movie, like, they're all on webcam at once, so they all have to be interacting with each other at once in real time, which I'm guessing the way they did that is the way I've seen other movies do that, is by having everyone in the same room, just with a different backdrop. Like,
yeah, most likely.
You know, so, like, everyone can hear each other, because that's the only way I could think of to do that.
Yeah, the actors are fine. Like, and
I really love the fat guy.
Yeah.
Like, the fat guy, I was really sad when he went. He was like my hero for most of the movie. Not just because I relate to fellow fatties.
I felt really bad for Adam because, like, of the friends, he was the least awful.
I don't know about that, because did they ever reveal what the fat guy did?
Oh, I don't think they did.
Yeah, whereas the Adam, like, at least mentioned that he roofied some chick to fuck her.
Oh, that's right.
Like, that's pretty fucking awful. But the fat kid, I don't remember them revealing anything about him.
His crime was
trying to delete the ghost from the computer.
Yeah.
That was his sole crime, because they never mentioned him doing anything else.
Yeah, you're right. Oh, man. I'd forgotten that. There's so much happening during a lot of these
reveals. Yeah, there's a lot of information to kind of take in at once. You know, because, like, because it's a Skype call, you constantly have, like, the Skype is moving. They take a few liberties with the computer. Like, when every time she pulls up a window over her Skype call, the Skype call volume goes, which you would not do. But I understand for clarity, they kind of.
Yeah. One of the things I did appreciate about the movie that didn't totally suck is the fact that it actually uses, for the most part, real computer programs.
Yes. And uses it, like, for the most part, the way they're used.
Yeah.
I was a little weirded out that her messaging program, for whatever reason, sometimes she would come back to it and it would just be empty. And I'm like, well, wouldn't it still have, like, the last exchange she had with the guy? But I don't know.
Yeah. But, like, if she goes to YouTube, it's YouTube. If she opens a web browser, it's Chrome.
It's Facebook. Facebook and Skype is where most of the conversation happens. And I actually really like that initial idea. That initial idea is creepy as fuck. A friend of yours is dead, and you receive a message from them on Skype. Like,
yeah.
You know, or a Facebook friend request from a friend that's dead. Like, that is a really cool idea. I feel like you could have done so much more with it.
Yeah, I like the idea that it was called Unfriended, and not only is it about you know, cyberbullying, but it's about the unraveling of this group of friends.
Yes, yes, you know? They actually do all become like not friends by the end, even though they're all
spoilers.
No one lives. With the exception of the fat guy, I think most of them kind of deserved it.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, it's like spreading rumors about your friend having an eating disorder because you're jealous of her, like roofying some chick to fuck her, like fucking ratting your friend out.
Ratting your friend out to the cops for something you did.
You know, fucking like the two people that were pretty much responsible for that video going up. You know, like, just, oh, jeez.
You know, the main character sells her boyfriend out at the end.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Well, even the fact that she held up that paper.
Yeah.
to save her boyfriend, even though she knew it was going to kill the other guy. And I'm like, I don't know if I could make that decision. Like, at least if he walks out, like, he dies, it's his decision. Like.
Yeah.
You know, so there are some tense moments. I just wish all the payoffs were actually good.
Yeah.
They're just kind of. Not, you know, and the acting's fine, and the pacing's fine. It's
all the things that don't work just make me feel bad for all the things that did.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
and I also don't understand. It's like, oh, we got all these compromising photos of people, and I'm just like, but these don't seem too compromising. You know, it's like,
yeah, it didn't feel like it was going far enough.
Like when I think like a compromising photo, I think like, oh, we got a photo of you topless blowing your gym teacher or something, you know, like
yeah,
something like that, you know, like something that would really fuck up your life if it got out. But
yeah, I don't know why the movie was R. Yeah. It felt PG-13.
There was a lot of swearing that kind of goes over your head when it's happening. You're not really cognizant of it. So that's the only thing I can think of. Or maybe the MPAA just since the 2000s have gotten really strict on it. I don't know. Then again, Evil Dead. Evil Dead went as far as any movie. So I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know.
Maybe they felt they were making a respectable horror movie. So they couldn't have nudity and they couldn't have. It won't explain why the MPAA gave it an R, because this, in order for a movie to be an R, I feel like it has to at least be effective on some level.
Well, I feel like at least there's got to at least be boobs.
Like Paranormal Activity was R, but at least I got that the movie was fucking terrifying. Like, it sticks with you. So at least I got that part. But
yeah, like Paranormal Activity is at least very intense.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, but yeah, like I don't think there's any nudity whatsoever in Unfriended.
There isn't. Like, there's a point where it's about to happen, and then later it looks like they're gonna use. This is the weirdest thing. There's a part where she, like, in the beginning of the movie where she's trying to cyber with her boyfriend, and she starts to take her top off, but she doesn't because all her friends enter the call because the ghost all called them, which is the first thing where I was just like, wait, Skype doesn't work that way. I'm like, oh, okay, the ghost is doing it. Okay. Rock on.
Yeah,
I'm in. But she's trying to take her top off, but she doesn't. But then later, it like the ghost put her video on like some porn site. But I'm like, but wait, she never took her top off. So what is that going to do? Like,
yeah,
like, she never actually does. She just gets this far.
If it had actually had happened, then it would.
Because then that would have been an effective moment.
Yeah.
You know, because it wouldn't have just been funny. It would have been funny and like, oh shit, like. But I don't understand. I don't understand, you know? The chemistry between everyone was pretty rock solid. You believe them as a group of friends.
Yeah, absolutely.
You also believe them as a group of friends that constantly fuck each other over.
Yep.
All I can say now is I feel bad for that guy. I don't know what he did wrong. He did nothing wrong except tried to stop the ghost. R.I.P. Fat Guy.